Welcome back, everybody, to game number two now between Power Rangers and CIS Rejects. Power Rangers, who just lost to CIS Rejects, I don't even know what to call it, sustained lineup something. Their whole Huskar, Razor, Queen of Pain cores go super, super late game and see what happens. They just lost to that. They can't really be feeling too confident going into game number two, but we'll see, as we have a Night Stalker first pick to a Tiny Wisp response from CIS Rejects. I'm Capitalist, going to be joined by Scant. Scant, what do you think about this opening? CIS Rejects going for the Tiny Wisp.
Tiny Wisp definitely makes a statement as an opening. It's one of, like, the make-a-statement openings that exist in professional Dota 2.
Uh-huh.
And it's going to define the rest of the draft, absolutely. I mean, the Wyvern pickup already, definitely, like, directly related to Wisp and Tiny. Not that Wyvern is, like, not a good hero in its own right. It's just especially good against that combination. I think both of these teams are using a new standard in this game from the previous game. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know what that's all about, but we now have Coots, right, who is the new stand-in for CIS Rejects, and we have Zara as the other new stand-in for Power Rangers.
Is the CIS region this unstable that from game to game...
you got me, man. You got me. I have no idea.
But yeah, it's interesting that CIS Rejects ban out Disruptor when the Wyvern's already there, because long ago people said Disruptor was like the counterpick to Wisp, and then people decided actually it's more like the Wyvern. And I don't know that I've seen teams pick both the Wyvern and the Disruptor against the Wisp strategy together. Feels like maybe you're committing too many things to do a particular thing in your draft. Also, Wyvern actually in many ways is a defensive support, I think, and Disruptor is more of an offensive, like, momentum-based support. So, I mean, CIS Rejects just, like, really not wanting to deal with it, despite the fact that I would say it's not really that likely. Then again, that the Nightstalker was already there, and that's... If there's ever a momentum aggression hero to combine with your glimpse, that's definitely one of them.
Yeah, and plus the vision advantage that you play with on a Night Stalker, I think, really benefits a Disruptor. So I could kind of see that. I could kind of see that. But
so what we're expecting to see from CIS Rejects is probably another dual lane and then one solo. And usually in the Wisp Tiny strategy, at least going back historically, traditionally, we'd see that the offlaner in this strategy has some kind of initiating power. If it's a Beastmaster or a Nyx Assassin or Doombringer or Batrider, something like that that could set up for relocate gank. Although, definitely in the last year or so, Wisp Tiny has not been picked as much as a proactive ganking strategy. I think it's worth talking about because definitely in the CIS region, there's still a temptation when you can make those ganks to make them. But it's quite often used as a farming, split-pushing, reactive combination of heroes at the moment, so I wouldn't commit as much as I might have in the past to them picking an initiating offlaner to go with their two dual lanes. Mm-hmm.
Witch Doctor now for CIS Rejects. Both a really strong support, and in a way can be a great hero against Tiny Wisp, so it might serve that double purpose in a way as kind of a block pick, but... We'll see. I would say, just as always, I'm never upset seeing a Witch Doctor picked up, like in that 3-4 area. He just feels like a very solid support that is all around.
That hero's so good, actually. It got a big buff in the recent patch. I mean, like they changed the way Aghanims worked, but I mean, the ulti's actually ridiculously good without Aghanims at this stage.
Mm-hmm.
And slot up pickup for Power Rangers. I wanted to mention, actually, Ember Spirit being completely ignored. A hero that's been, like, top priority in most drafts I've seen in the last few weeks. And I guess Power Rangers may be nervous to run the Ember Spirit after what happened last game, where, like, everything that the Ember wants had happened and just wasn't enough on its own to win the game. I suppose CIS Rejects could pick it up themselves. Maybe a bit greedy to run the Ember and Tiny together, but then again, those exact greedy... Two super scaly cores strategies have been quite popular recently, especially teams like Monkey Business. Not as much on LAN, but online, they were drafting those dual cores of, like, heroes that fight early but also scale very far quite a lot. And I think Tiny and Ember was actually one of the ones they preferred.
What is this Night Stalker a four position?
Dire team pick. Are you wondering about the slaughter?
Yeah. Is this going to be an offlane Slardar and a four position Night Stalker? Or are we going to see an offlane Night Stalker and a one position Slardar?
I think we're going to see a one position Slardar. I think that's like a Templar assassin. It's the CIS pick.
Especially
with the TA.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing. For me, like the pause that I had about the one position Slardar is that you needed that sort of like the carry that can make up for maybe the Slardar's lack of late game potential. And for me, it's usually the SF, but I forgot about the Templar Assassin, especially the Dire side. It makes a lot of sense. So, one position Slardar and most likely an offlane Night Stalker. I think that's where I prefer him. I don't really like the four position Night Stalker as much. I feel you don't have enough impact in the game.
Yeah, four position Night Stalkers, from what I've seen, like, they only seem to do well when the Night Stalker gets a bit lucky early on, succeeds in some early ganks at very low level, which shouldn't necessarily happen for, like, a level 1 or 2 Night Stalker. So I think I'd agree with you there. I really like the Beastmaster pick here. I think the vision is going to be very important in this game when you're against Night Stalker, those TA traps. Also, just dealing with the threat to rush all the time from TA and Slaughter. Mm-hmm. And then, obviously, what I was saying before about Beastmaster being able to initiate for a relocate, which... I mean, a Slaughter with the early blink or sprints plus a TA with the early blink, you can't actually kill with relocate. Throw in the Beastmaster and suddenly you can. And Razor Witch Doctor, by the way, is if they do run Whisper Tiny Mid, this is like one of the best defensive dual lanes to handle aggressive lanes. So if they're anticipating an aggressive dual lane, which with the Lich pick seems extremely likely to me, Razor and Witch Doctor actually handles aggressive dual lanes better than most.
Okay, so offlane Beastmaster. Yeah, okay, I can kind of see this. CIS Rejects, I like their lineup. I'm just a little bit worried that perhaps it's too greedy and they're just going to get snowballed by the Night Stalker and Slardar, who both come online really early. Because, like, all three of their cores need a significant amount of farm. Like, Beastmaster usually goes to Necronomicon build. Razor has his own set of items, whether it's Mechanism, whether it's going to be in, like, an S&Y build. And then, obviously, Tiny Wisp is kind of like your hard carry lane. So I'm a bit concerned about the amount of farm that they need on the side of CIS Rejects. But as you said, I think that their laning phase is actually going to be all right, particularly, as you said, the Razor. I think he does... better against this matchup than most other carries would.
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, the thing is, so if you have these aggressive dual lanes where you try to put pressure, I mean, usually I'd say Witch Doctor Razor is one of the best dual lanes against them because it's very difficult to pressure either. Then Witch Doctor can save Razor. Razor's difficult to go on. With the Lich, it does complicate things a little bit. Although I'm not sure that Lich is gonna be laning bot all the time. Looks like he's walking around. He might even wanna.
Oh yeah, he might just stay mid. Yeah. So he'll be the one denying creeps and stacking up ancients for the TA.
And that's... I want to say that if there's a concern about farm spread on CIS Rejects, we should look at whichever hero is being denied creeps by Lich.
Yeah.
Because that's the hero who we need to see. Do they still get the farm they need?
So the Slardar Winter Wyvern versus the Beastmaster. Wisp just coming up here. Are they going? Oh, I was gonna say they might go for the toss play if there was some sort of fight. Have you seen that before?
Yeah, with the Wisp.
Where the Wisp tethers over, but he gets stuck on the cliff, and then you just toss.
Yeah, there was a whole video about doing that in the offlane, I think, where there's that new spot. I don't know if you know where it's, like, somewhere over here, where you can just, like, at the lane. Wisp
oh,
can
really?
Get up there, and you can toss people onto that spot. Yeah.
Oh, that's absurd. What?
Pretty ridiculous, actually.
How does Wisp even get up there? Does he, like, tether and then cancel tether?
Yeah, he's got to tether, like, across from above to below and then some arc, yeah.
Yeah, okay. I can kind of map that out in my head.
So, right. I think Wisp and Tiny versus TA is extremely favorable for Wisp and Tiny. I don't know what you think about this thing.
Yeah, I agree. It should be quite good for them. The Beastmaster... he's having to deal with the lane that it's going to be a bit annoying just because the offensive power of the Slardar potentially, but he should be all right for the most part as long as he doesn't get caught too heavily. I mean, it's essentially just like a Razor matched up against a Night Stalker at the bottom lane, which is quite favorable. I think the supports kind of cancel each other out. So, yeah, the lane will be forwards a lot of the time. And Power Rangers will be able to pick up a full amount of experience, but it won't change the fact that the CS War should go the favor of the Razor.
So, There's one thing that I actually didn't know until too recently, which is a little bit embarrassing, but I don't know, other people might not know this too. In Dota 1, Tiny's Avalanche was like really good against Tier's Refraction and just took it off instantly and burst her. Mm-hmm. In Dota 2, it's never really been that way. It actually only has 4 instances of damage, which for the early levels will still be fine. But once Refraction's maxed, you can't just like be Tiny and go on Tier.
Yeah, it used to be like something, I think it was double the instances.
Yeah, so I think it was 8 and now it's 4.
Which was absurd. Like, you just like, you'd be able to grab him, avalanche, toss him, you would be able to get the toss damage in there every single time through the refraction, just thanks to your combo being able to eat through it immediately, no matter what level it was. And that was a significant counter. But yeah, as you said, right now, Tiny's actually not as good versus Templar Assassin as he used to be.
Yeah, the lane's still very favorable for them, but they don't just have this like instant free kill on TA when she has refraction up. It's actually quite difficult to kill her.
See, Big Num.
But yeah,
he's pulling up the hard camp.
Sorry, go ahead.
No worries. He's just pulling out the hard camp right now, nothing special.
I've been looking at this bot lane every now and then, and it seems like every time Lich runs in to throw a Nova, Razor and Witch Doctor turn around and say, no, you're not the one harassing here, and like throw a bunch of right clicks, sometimes a cask or a chain onto Lich.
Oh, Gortz is going to be chased down. Looks like they got this kill with the Orb of Venom. Never mind, they can't commit to it, especially with that boar. In fact, the boar now trying to damage Big Num when I felt like maybe he could have forced out something from our Slardar, but Beastmaster got to be a bit careful. I like the additional slow. Oh, the healing salve. Part of it gets canceled too. These boars are just so obnoxious if played correctly. Lane is going to push forward. Meanwhile, there's a haste on Koods in this middle lane. Doesn't look like they're going to make anything of it. Templar Assassin should be fine, but
I wonder if Koods is like a specialist worst player. I feel like if you get a new stand-in in the middle of a series, like Wisp is not the hero I expect you to give them. Like,
oh yeah,
like some brand new person. So it might be that this is like his hero that he plays all the time.
Yeah, it could be.
But yeah, in terms of the CS trades, I would say that things are going pretty well for CIS Rejects.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Beastmaster doesn't have that many creeps, but he's getting a lot of space actually against this lane, threatening them himself.
Yeah.
Oh, Bodrin, there's going to be a contest here.
Yeah, they're going to fight over it with the Templar Assassin. It should be an easy win here for... oh, maybe not that cast goal. Oh, what a beautiful cast. Bounces out perfectly. The Nightstalker is given space now to jump ahead and get the Void onto Goblack. And looks like they will be able to get that one kill. Koots comes in trying to heal up, but First Blood is the bounty there for Power Rangers. But now they keep on jumping forward. They manage to pop the Invis Rune, turn around, kills the Razor as well. Iceberg is pretty far out here all by his lonesome. But then again, Power Rangers, they've completely run out of mana. And Cheshire Cat should be fine unless he gets blocked in too much. But it's actually Iceberg he gets blocked in by the neutrals. And Cheshire Cat runs himself away. 2 kills go to PR even after CIS Rejects choose to turn and fight. In that scenario, they still lose their Razor.
And both kills go to Nightstalker, who's got an entire Urden Art on the career.
Oh, wow. And they're going to jump in. Goretz, he's going to be doubly slowed down, and Power Rangers will be able to pick up this extra kill as he gets a lot of damage, but the Cold Embrace is there, and Slardar will survive.
I got to say that it's questionable decision making from CS Rejects to take the fight at the Botrian. It was the 4-minute rune spawning. That's when first night starts, and it's like Nightstalker wants that. Like,
yeah.
Oh, it's first night. Where do I have a fight? And like they're just obliged.
Mm-hmm. No, they absolutely did.
He's got his early urn. He sees Goblack here. I don't think he can solo kill him, even with the clarity running. He's only gonna have one void.
Yeah, he doesn't have a mango anymore. So he's met by the Razor, and fortunately his movement speed is enough to cancel that damage drain. He was hoping the Witch Doctor would run himself back, but that's very obviously a bad play for Goblack. He just hides himself underneath the tower and waits out the Nightstalker to show himself. Now, they did get a kill on the Beastmaster in the top lane, but that hasn't really changed Beastmaster's aggressive positioning. He's 13-1, still getting plenty of CS and actually getting almost a full amount of experience now being level 5.5.
Yeah, that's true. So in terms of like getting experience and gold, I think lane stage still fine for CS Rejects. But considering the fact that Power Rangers are running that Nightstalker in TA, they've got that potential to snowball just like last game. The fact that they've got that early kill lead is also very significant for them. And Nightstalker's not going to move into that mid lane. This is where they're going to look for a kill by the looks of it. Maybe yeah, on the Wisp.
Between that fight bottom and if this fight middle goes well, for me, Power Rangers, we'll see exactly what we're talking about, which is them just kind of snowballing. Nice toss. It actually gives them a little bit of space, and they slow down Cheshire Cat quite significantly. Will not be enough to be able to stick around for that second void, so they actually chase him out. So a great response there from Iceberg, tossing him back into the Wisp, and then they also get the slow from the tether as well.
I think it's still an overall win for Power Rangers because they baited the Razors to TP in. I'm not sure if Razor had to TP in, but they've got really good disengage. They pull out almost effortlessly. So even though CIS Rejects dealt well with the initial aggression, I think Power Rangers get value out of that, and Cheshire Cat, when the game gets unpaused, will probably just move straight to that top lane and see if he can catch out the Beastmaster. Mm-hmm. I wonder why they didn't just target the Wisp, though, because I feel like it was always going to be tough to kill Tiny there, and it's always a different story if you target the Wisp or the Wisp's partner in terms of the heal and sustain.
Yeah. No, I agree. Plus the fact that they're going in without a silence. It's not that this build is bad. I like the Hunter in the night at level 2. I think that just adds a lot more to your killing power. But still, the fact that you're going into that fight without that silence does make a big difference on whoever you're going on.
Well, we're going to see an unpause, and I do think Cheshire Cat's headed straight to that top lane. I'm not sure. Yeah, he's going for it, and I don't think he's been spotted, actually.
Yeah, he can make a dive.
There's no level 6 on BM yet. It's like one creep away.
Yeah, they got the slow on him. They'll just quickly... pretty much chainstun him down with that amplify damage. They take out the Beastmaster so damn quickly. In the meantime, the Templar Assassin managed to pick up a double damage rune, which Iceberg needs to be careful about. Meld plus double damage actually could be enough to pop Iceberg if they choose to fight, but now they've got the backup of the Witch Doctor, and Zara's just trying to escape through the bottle up. Not quite enough. A big hit from the Tiny is enough to be able to get the kill.
Yeah, I want to say it's not a huge loss for Power Rangers because TA's got that big ancient stack to go farm. Lich actually is the one who got the space because of that trade, and we're going to see a level 6 on Lich in that bot lane. So maybe using that chain frost early on.
Oh, it's a fight. Cheshire Cat has just enough time to be able to get out the void before the roar of Goretz, and he'll be able to get out as well. The pathway isn't blocked unless he goes... Well, okay, I guess he was blocked out earlier. Cold Embrace will buy him some time, but there's going to be another round of axes, and he's kind of surrounded here, so he will end up dying. I guess I didn't realize Iceberg was coming in through the secret shop area, so he had to go through the tier 1.
To me, it still continues the thought that I was getting at there, though, which is that even when CIS Rejects get kills, I feel like they're making much more of it. They're committing a lot more, bringing in everyone every time to try and get something. And Beastmaster's in trouble. Goretz? No, he's got Go Black here. It should be okay.
Yeah, Go Black still has the Mango too, so he can even pop it and throw out the cask if they chase.
It's a very interesting decision by Power Rangers to just leave the Lich in the spot lane. Even after level 6, he's just like, I'm not going to go anywhere. I mean, he might TP into the middle of a fight if one happens at a tower, but... seems like he's more than happy to just get some farm for himself and keep the Razor down.
There is a decent amount of value in the armor. But even then, it seems kind of weird. If Lich is staying in lane, do you think that puts more credence into a maxed out sacrifice build?
Yeah, it usually would. Because, yeah. I mean, he's staying here to like keep the Razor down, I would think. Unless he's like trying to farm himself a Midas or something. Right. I suppose he's nearby to protect the Ancient Stack, which is
Oh, sorry, he's going to be caught, but he just popped the Refraction. So he'll be okay for the time being. Cheshire Cat is going to go for Coots here. They do have the TP in. Bignum has the Winter's Curse. They're going to be able to blow up the Wisp. And now Iceberg, he's going to be next with all that Amplify damage. The nuke does so much. And they'll go back to farming up this Ancient Stack. If you're going to contest a Templar Assassin like this, you got to make sure to bring more than just two heroes.
It should actually be the other heroes and just threaten the relocate, but yeah. Wisp isn't even level 6 yet.
Yeah, they'd actually stayed in lane and rotated everyone else. Maybe the Wisp does pick up his level 6 in time for like an actual engagement, but as is, that seemed just like poor planning for the CIS Rejects. Let's take a look at the net worth. Yes, Tiny is the top, but the three heroes behind him are all PR. Still trying out. Sort of weird how they just keep going one by one to contest.
Yeah, it goes back to that efficiency thing we were talking about before. I feel like Power Rangers brought in their whole team to protect the stack and they just got 2-0. Whereas when CIS Rejects bring in the whole team, they like get a 1-1 usually. They're gonna try and actually finish up the stack. If they get it and get away, it'll be a pretty good, still a pretty good deal for them.
Yeah, with the axes, it'll be alright, but now they're gonna take some harassment. Just that one nuke from the switch to blast. Now the slowdown of the trap they can actually catch here with another trap being laid down as the Templar Assassin gets closer. The Chain Frost bouncing around. This is a beauty! Oh, it just keeps on going. The relocate out. Goblack is almost dropped alone by that one. And looks like they'll get Ramses as well. So they'll get that. It looks like the rest of the heroes are going to wait out the Wisp. So as he dies, the Wisp goes back right into the jump. Oh, the big melt strike. Slow him down enough with that trap that they'll catch up and get another right click. But Hoot still gets away. Unless another nuke, another trap, slowing him down. And Iceberg, he's got to try and stop this one. They turn around. Nice cask. Big Num's going to be going down here shortly as the next nuke is coming up. Toss in 2 seconds, and he doesn't have the mana to stop this one. Just throws out another Splinter Blast. Iceberg keeps moving forward, burns the Refraction, toss up the air, and the right click does the trick. Double kill for Iceberg, and now Cheshire Cat coming from the side. Almost has enough damage to finish up Iceberg. Avoid, and he'll get the kill. So at least they get that turnaround through the end of the darkness, but they really got to start backing up here as they don't want to be fighting anymore. Ramsey's now going to join this brawl in the middle lane. Cheshire Cat being brought low is slowed down enough by the boar because he doesn't have that extra movement speed during daytime. He's just going to be slowly right-click down unless the Winter's Curse comes in. Oh, right before the last hit, turn around, Void just taunting Ramsey's. He'll die to the nuke, but still, they get the Razor in the end. Nightstalker, he gave it his all. He's 7-2-4 now. And facilitated with his death, the kill on the Razor. Well worth it, it looks like, for Power Rangers, but it looked kind of nasty until the Nightstalker came in and got those two different kills for them. That
Tiny both just picked up flicks. And Tiny's using his right now, Lich is dead.
Okay, there goes the Lich. Combination. Wombo combo time. Looks
so
like they'll finally finish up the
not
stack.
Gonna let up on the aggression anytime soon, I think.
Yeah. I think this is really important for CIS Rejects to go the Blink Dagger build on the Tiny because we talked about how their cores needed farm. And Big Num slowing down. Iceberg is going to be turned around on here. Does still have the Cold Embrace, but won't be able to get it in time. He's just chain stunned down. Still though, the Slaughter can get there. Oh god, the cask! He just keeps on interrupting at the perfect times. It looks like Cheshire Cat really wants to go for the kill. He's going to stop that relocate out, jump in, two-man stun to finish off the Wisp, and now go on to Ramses. He's a dangerous one, though. He's got a lot of HP, still has plenty of magic wand charges. The Slardar does get popped, but the Razor falls as well. Cheshire Cat, the cast bouncing around, but now here comes a Chain Frost. What is with these bouncing abilities? They're just doing so much work in these fights. It goes right back in, almost finishing off that boar. Goes on to Go Black, who may now still die to J-Force. He gets the extra nuke in to finish him off. Power Rangers win another fight, though they did lose their Slardar. He's going to be fine with it, though. I mean, he picked up his Blink Dagger beforehand, jump in, J4, almost dies to that one, gets off his nuke. He'll die, but it's well worth it as he gets the turnaround kill with the help of Cheshire Cat and Big Num.
Is this an only mid game?
I think so. Winter's Curse now onto Koods with Gorantz hitting him. Koods is going to be going down with a Splinter Blast to finish him off. Don't go for more, though, Power Rangers. You're killing me. These team fights are lasting way too long. I need to catch my breath, plus it's just not going to work out.
Wow, I wish that the game displayed after each Lich ulti how many times it bounced, because it has a potential for 10, but I feel like mostly in professional Dota games you'll see 3 or 4, or 5 maybe,
uh-huh.
And in this game he's had 2 chain for us and I feel like they've been like 7 or 8 each. It's just like incredible how much it's bounced around and how much work it's done.
Yeah, between the cast and the Chain Frost, there have been both like, toss back, cast, bounce. Oh, it doesn't get the lucky bounce this time. Go Black.
It's really funny, the Chain Frost and the cast go like it'll bounce to creeps and just be on the creeps wall and then come back at an important time and hit a hero, set up another kill.
The Lich now almost has a mech based on all this farm that he's getting from these fights. Bottom lane, they're going to try and go on Slardar. But nice stun in order to finish up that blink. Relocate back out. Go Black is caught inside the river area here. Goretz and the Razor are sitting on the side here, wanting to be able to initiate. Looks like they're going to go on the Slardar. J4 doesn't have a Chain Frost just yet. He doesn't have the charges for it, unfortunately. Now throws it out, but it's a bit too late. It's going to bounce back and forth once or twice. Actually goes back to Koots and hits him again. Oh, he's not getting lucky. Not this time. And now J4 has kind of been baited into death here. Shinsha Cat's going to run for it. They're all pretty low. Cold Embrace will actually save him up. Splinter Blast goes on to Coot. And now Shinsha Cat wants to finish him off. He's done so much right-click damage as I realize he's finished up an armlet already. Triple kill for Cheshire Cat. He's going ham this game. 12-2-7.
Yeah, it's exactly the right build for this kind of game. It's like doing work immediately. While that fight broke out, actually, I mean, they kind of merged into each other, but Cheshire Cat's first kill in that triple kill was on the Tiny in the river, who was running down to the bot lane all on his own, gets caught by Nightstalker and just blown up.
Yeah.
There's so much potential now for this Nightstalker to just dominate the fights that I think that maybe CIS Rejects need to focus him with like a roar into Tiny burst combo, because they're not going to deal well with him if they're letting him run in and out and armlet toggle and spam all his spells.
All right, five-man smoke after taking Roshan. Power Rangers, they know they've got a serious advantage, and this is the biggest fear. CIS Rejects were just going to get rolled over in that 15-minute marker, and it seems to be happening. Cheshire Cat, unfortunately, wrong time to run across that gap as the Witch Doctor pops the smoke, but is still able to stay out of range of all these heroes. It looks like CIS Rejects are going to try and catch something here. They're going to go for Big Nub turnaround, Winter's Curse, and looks like Iceberg's just going to get bursted down unless the cast can actually save him. Nice relocate over to the side. That'll be able to save one. It looks like they're going to get Zara, finish off that Aegis, and Slaughter. Well, he's trying to get out as well. Shishir Cat just went in, though. He's already taken out the Witch Doctor. Go back into the reincarnating Templar Assassin, who gets taken out by the Tiny Wisp combination. Two down in exchange for the Witch Doctor, plus they took away the Aegis on the side of Power Rangers. Great initiation and great follow-up once again from this Witch Doctor. Koblax paralyzing casts have been on point all game long.
Yeah, there's a really good relocate as well in the middle of the fight just to break it up, keep the Tiny alive. And I think if it wasn't for the fact that Nightstalker was so ridiculously strong right now, that could have been even more of a massacre. I mean, as things stand, it was essentially a 3-for-1, which is pretty good when you're playing from behind.
What do you build next as Nightstalker? Do you go BKB? I think you do. I don't know. It's hard to say, right? Because it's not necessarily the greatest ability or greatest item for this game because you still have plenty of physical damage. Radiant's bottom
tower is under attack. I think he might just go straight for that Ags at this point.
Yeah, okay.
It's just insane value, and he's strong enough in fighting anyway that if he doesn't get roared, he's probably not going to die.
Yeah. Plus, you don't, like, if you end up falling behind, you don't want to be struggling to still get your ags, right? Because the BKB, like, if you win fights and you keep going, you could still get an Aghanim Scepter maybe, like, 5 to, you know, 8, 10 minutes after you've completed your BKB. But if it doesn't go well, you start stalling up, then you don't have that insane value that you're talking about as you start going mid to late game, and that's going to be hugely problematic for Power Rangers. So I like your idea of the Aghanim Scepter as the second item.
There's going to be attempts at the tier 1 for Power Rangers mid. It doesn't look like there's an attempt to fight, strangely enough. It's actually just a trade at the top lane. Not something that we commonly see between these two teams in this series. But now there's the TP to the top lane. So.
Winter Wyvern, he just saw the combo go out from Iceberg, so he's feeling pretty confident about being aggressive here. He's going to try and stop Iceberg. Oh, what? Oh my god, did you see that?
Yeah, that's...
Is that auto attack on? Either way, that's still absurd that Craggy got him.
Yeah, I think that he gets out anyway because the Wisp was planning the relocate either way.
Yeah.
But a bit of a strange one nonetheless. And another tower trade at the bot lane, tier 2, where Beastmaster's actually picked up his Necro level 1. They didn't actually get the tier 1 top, but it's deniable. Probably will be denied soon.
I think this is still okay for Power Rangers. I mean, they're taking tier 1 middle and tier 1 top in exchange for a tier 1 and tier 2. It's not terribly bad. It's when they start losing a lot of HP on their tier 3 tower that I start getting really concerned. Time to TP back, Power Rangers. They don't have a TP yet. Oh, neither one of these heroes have his TP back, so that's part of the problem. A tier 3 is going to go down. Chain Frost gets laid out. Looks like they're going to start coming back, but Iceberg is just able to TP himself out ahead of everyone else. Power Rangers just really dropped the ball there.
Yeah, a bit of a strange one, and definitely good decision-making by CIS Rejects. Good awareness to notice that they could get that much value off the map. The biggest concern for Power Rangers right now is actually Tia, who picked up her Desolator just then as the tier 3 was going down. Because she really needs to be doing damage output in their team. They can't rely on Nightstalker plus Chain Frost to do damage every fight. Well, they can rely on it in the pickoffs, but... I don't know, maybe Nightstalker goes even more of a combat orientated build at this stage, because TA is just like actually quite far behind where she wants to be at this stage.
Oh, turnaround silence. They know Koritz is going to get the roar eventually, so they got to buy themselves time, perhaps for TP's in. They've already got Goritz pretty low. He finally gets a roar off. Now the jump in from Iceberg. They're going to pop Cheshire Cat, or maybe not quite. He gets off the void, gets that one kill. Cass bouncing around, but now the heroes are in deep, and here comes the Sarner making his initiation, trying to finish off Go Black. Gets the lucky bash, enough time for Templar Assassin to get that one kill. Now the nuke comes out, it's enough to get that, but Razor's now committed against a Templar Assassin who has a Desolator. He'll be able to get that kill, but Iceberg comes in. The fragile Templar Assassin doesn't stand a chance, and now they're being run down. J4 and Big Num, the supports don't have a chance against the Tiny Wisps. All they can hope for is a TP out from one of them. J4's not going to be as lucky, though. He gets some distance, but maybe buys out. Eventually, he'll be run down by Iceberg. 4-3 as the Tiny Wisp. They're really the big winners of that engagement. They have a straight-up Aghanim Scepter now for the Tiny.
And Cheshire Cat actually did opt for the BKB as he was dying there. So I guess figuring that then there is only one spell that controls him, and he really does need to do carrying right now.
Yeah.
Probably the ideal thing for Nightstalk would have been if he could have like bought a BKB or Blink Tag or something for his TA, but I mean, Dota doesn't let you do that, so
yeah.
He's got to pick up the ball.
No, but that really, I mean, you bring up a good point. That really is the big downside of Power Rangers right now, is that the Templar Assassin is so much farther down in net worth than everyone else. Oh, oh dear. Oh, just needed one more right click, too. One more, and he would have had it. He kind of has to lead with Void. Maybe if he popped his BKB, though, he would have gotten that kill. He would have.
Yeah. That's a very tough call, though, popping a BKB in that situation.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't blame him for it too much. The funny thing with the Templar Assassin, we spoke at the start about how Avalanche Toss is not a combo that kills her through Refraction, but what keeps happening in these fights is Refraction gets used up beforehand, and then Tiny does just blast her. She's way too weak when her Refract's done.
Got a mech now for Wiss, so add in a huge amount of survivability for CIS Rejects at this point.
Oh, they're gonna run straight into Goblack, and he's dead. He is dead.
So five-man committal for Power Rangers. It's one of those ganks that'll get you a kill and a tower, though.
He was actually trying to go place a ward to scout against this kind of rotation.
Oh no, he's just a bit too late.
Yeah.
Poor guy. Still the right idea. Looks like they're still going to try and force fights, though, while taking that bottom lane. They're going to go for Goritz here. Pop of the BKB will be able to get that kill. The relocate not out for Koots. They're going to jump now onto the Slardar. The sprint, it gets him fast, but it doesn't make him much tankier as he easily falls to the Dukes. They're going to go into Koots next. Chain Frost bouncing around, slowing down Iceberg. Koots, nice jump around there with a tether, but Iceberg just took so much damage from that combination. He took almost every other Chain Frost bounce. Now Koots is being run down by Cheshire Cat, who has another Void, and will be able to finish off with the help of the Urn. Goes on next. He's got to be careful, though. There goes the Witch Doctor. Ultimate Call of the Price comes in at the right time. Cheshire Cat has been saved, and Go Black has to run himself away. Can't commit to that Nightstalker kill, but it looks like he's still going to be run down by the Templar Assassin. Just three shots. Nice and easy, and Ramses, well, he's slow, but he's still a Razor, so he's going to be fast enough to stay ahead of that Templar Assassin. Still, though, TA picking up that kill is huge, because it wasn't so long ago that we were just looking at only a Desolator for this TA. Now we can see a complete Blink Dagger soon.
Yeah, and I feel like the trump card in that fight is Winter's Curse on Tiny before he does too much.
Yeah.
I mean, there was Chain Frost hitting them. There was all sorts of stuff dealing damage to them. But ultimately, if Power Rangers are grouped around him and they get the Winter's Curse, they will be able to kill him. And he's the big damage output. TA is not actually that underfarmed relative to Razor or Beastmaster. It's just to the Tiny that keeps blowing up.
Trying to catch up to J4. They missed the relocate, but it doesn't really matter when you've got a Blink Dagger. So, they still catch up.
This next rush is going to be a major point of contention. It's very easy for Power Rangers to kill. It will be up quite soon. And it'll definitely mitigate against like one of their major weaknesses, because I think they'll probably give Aegis to TA at this point. And if she can't be blown up, then they'll be very happy to just go in guns blazing. Oh, she can solo kill this Wisp at bot lane.
Certainly can. Three shot. I mean, that's the downside. Like, the mech is great. What's happening top lane? Looks like they're going to catch our Slardar here. He's trying to finish up his armlet, and he was so close to it, too. Are they going to get more? Cheshire Cat's going to run right into Goretz. Oh, he used his Primal Roar earlier, though. That was on the kill on the Lich. And that means they don't have a controlling ability against Cheshire Cat. Fortunately, the nighttime. Oh, man, he's just so slowed down by that boar. The nuke isn't quite there in time. He still had the BKB going, but he dies in the end still. And CIS Rejects taking control of this Tier 2 tower. Two pickoffs like that, and they may even feel confident going uphill because Cheshire Cat's down for 45 seconds.
Your offlane Nightstalker is the second highest net worth in the game. He's got a BKB, a plate mail, an armlet, strength treads. He gets taken down by boar.
Uh-oh. Controlled up. Iceberg. He's going to be focused down by Zara, but he's having some issues with that Craggy. Never mind. A big Mel nuke is enough still. Now they're going to focus on the Razor. He's going to be the big damage dealer, but he's already getting so much sustain out from that Wisp. They're going to come in now with the extra nuke and the amplified damage. They will be able to get that kill before Kuth can bring him back with a relocate. And now it's just cleanup time. How many more heroes can they get? Gord's going to be the target, but a cask. Oh, no. It's happening all over again. J4 is going to man up and try and go for it. He's rather squishy, though, only sitting on 300 HP, but he feels confident enough to go for Go Black. Slowing him down. Looks like they're going to still run down Goretz, though. It's the power of the Slardar. So damn fast. Go Black turns, fights J4, but a TP in from Cheshire Cat. Oh, it's not nighttime. It's not nighttime, and he doesn't have darkness, so he can't actually go for that kill.
It was nighttime when he died, though, by the way, to the boar, which is, like, it's pretty incredible, actually. They, like, locked him down, and he couldn't get away. All the items he has at nighttime. I respect to Beastmaster's boar. But this is Rush. This is Rush, and I said it might be a point of contestation, but there's no chance. It's dead long before CS Rejects can even think about coming in. Yeah.
Look at it. It just drops in like 5 seconds flat. Amplify damage, plus the Desolator and Meld. So much minus armor between them.
And there's a secondary armlet actually up on the side of Power Rangers now on Slaughter. I guess figuring that Nightstalker's had so much success with the armlet toggling, like, there's just opportunities. And actually, Slaughter, I think, is quite a good hero for that, because you can blink in and out, sprint in and out. Yeah. It's pretty easy to get that, like, small gap to toggle your armlets in the fight if you need to. There's a DD in the bottle of TA, which hasn't been used yet.
Yeah, so that could be a big factor in the next upcoming team fight, but it may not be a team fight at all. Oretz, he was so close. He just wanted to get a Primal Roar and a pickoff on the Lich.
Have you seen what Lich is buying? This is incredible. I mean, I don't think this is the build, usually.
Usually, yes, but for whatever reason, this game, I almost think it has value.
Like, this game, it's like, it's... We're just going to see like 40 bounces or something like.
Yeah, it's going to be absurd. It looks like they found a pickoff on Go Black defending their base. Oh, they actually got the Winter's Curse on a Razor. Surprised he came back in like that. He's just going to be run down. I don't think anybody's... Oh, okay, relocate save. But other than that, nobody else is going to try and save.
Iceberg staying around for a while, but eventually... Yeah. I think his teammates talked him out of it. He was like, guys, come on, I want to stun toss.
That's just... Not going to be a viable jump. Cheshire Cat going on to Goretz now. The boar is out, though, and that's still such a... You just can't chase as a Night Stalker. Yeah. Beastmaster, I mean, I'm really feeling like... I didn't look at it this way before, but the Beastmaster may be a very good counter to the Night Stalker in a lot of ways, purely because of that boar. It's just so absurd how good that slow is. I mean, it's a what, 40% slow compared to your 35% movement speed?
Yep, and it's like so vital to Nightstalker that you have that move speed advantage. Yeah. It's so vital to how the hero plays, being able to go in and out of fights and like, just like, it reminds me a bit of how Batrider played at the height of Batrider. Uh-huh. You know, you can just go around the fight however you like and control what's going on, but if you're being locked on by a boar, you simply can't do that.
Yeah, before I didn't really see it that way, but I guess Beastmaster is significantly tanky. One of the big things for me was like, okay, but Nightstalker has a high amount of armor, and Beastmaster has got this like cross between physical damage from his wild axes and this control of Primal Roar, but there's actually significant part of Beastmaster is a direct counter to what Night Stalker likes to do. One, burst down heroes, and two, use his mobility as an advantage. Plus it's a vision game, right? Like, there is the downside. Yes, your Hawks won't be able to survive very long once you have Aghanims. And speaking of that, Cheshire Cat isn't going for Aghanims for whatever reason, going AC. But once you have the Ags gem on the Night Stalker, you just clean up Hawks left and right. But, of course, that's going to happen anyway. You still have to get vision of some kind, and the Hawk gives exactly what you need.
So I'm thinking about why Night Stalker doesn't go Ags this game. Originally not going for it, I think it's just recognition TA is far behind. She's actually caught up quite substantially now.
Mm-hmm.
I think that now the thinking is still that because your other cause is Slaughter, and Slaughter's kind of like infamous for not having as much damage output as most one position heroes, despite the fact that he reduces armor so much, it's just like his hits don't do that much, they're quite slow. So having that extra core top lane, Witch Doctor, yeah, Goblex, he's going to be deserted, I think.
Yeah, no one tries to jump in. They spot Coots. He's coming back for his Tiny because he's going to pop out now and go on to Big Numb. Who is going to be able to get off the Glimmer Cape and actually stays alive? Looks like there's a fight at the bottom lane at the same time. There's still the Winter's Curse. Looks like Coots is going to be popped here. Cheshire Cat comes back. Big Numb's going to die at the same time. Coots, oh, he's getting a little bit of help from the melee creeps. Body blocking up Cheshire Cat, but he won't be able to tether away. What happened at that bottom lane, though? I saw the Templar Assassin got a kill on the Razor. That's a big one.
Yeah, and then just cleaned up the Beastmaster afterwards. I was also looking at the top fights. It's also pretty interesting because the team with the Wisp and Tiny get outmaneuvered in two places at once. Slaughter, I don't know if you can do this.
Yeah, you yes, you are the quote-unquote safe lane farmer, but you do not have the kind of power to challenge a Tiny. He's got not double your net worth, but 1.6 times your net worth at least.
Again, I gotta say, there's like a failure in communication or outmaneuvering, because Wisp and Tiny could have gone to that fight, and then suddenly they have the numbers, because Power Rangers commits to two places at once. But instead, they take both fights and lose the one, and I don't know if they lost the one at the top. I mean, it's only the Wisp that died, the Tiny killed the Wyvern, I guess that's about even. But they lost four heroes, so yeah. It's an overall loss for sure.
Talisman for the Tiny, so probably Butterfly up next. I really like Butterfly Tiny. Ever since No Tail has revealed that Butterfly first, Butterfly over AC build, had a particularly
great
love. I mean, the movement speed that you get from the flutter effect is actually so absurd. I can't believe there was something that was added to Butterfly. I guess it kind of... No, it didn't really need it to be added. The flutter effect for Butterfly? I mean, Butterfly is still...
Thing is, if you go back a bit, the item was actually quite underbought, especially before the change to the break mechanic. And I mean, right now to counter Butterfly, you have to buy MKB.
Yeah, that's
but it's not
that
long
me.
Ago, you could get Hex or.
Mm-hmm. That's for me. The biggest thing is that the break mechanic comes in, and then it's like, okay, you have to have MKB or a break mechanic. And whereas before it was just like, oh, Scythe of Ice, it's all good.
Yeah. So. I mean, when I first saw No-Tail doing the Butterfly Tiny, it was like a Huskar strategy. It was like once he hit Butterfly, now he's pushing your base and you can't kill him. Because nobody on your team is ready to buy MKB, nobody's got a way to deal with that. But yeah, I agree with you. In general, I just really like it as a pickup now on the hero. Dire's top tower is
under attack. Bignum, here to defend the base. But it's okay, maybe it's not a bit too late. He's got the Winter's Curse. They're going to slow down Iceberg. Bingham's going to go in through the back and try and stop the relocate, but he's got no more stuns. That would have had to be the job of someone else to stop the Wisp going in like that. So they'll get another pick off on the Wisp, but that's all.
Yeah, I was asking earlier if this is your specialist Wisp player. I honestly think it could be, because how many times this game he's like at an important time saved the hero, and if each of those times it's the core going down and not him. I mean, obviously they're playing differently because they know they have a Wisp to save them, but he's gotten it right essentially every time. Most of his deaths are dying for someone else, and he has 12 of them, so that's a lot of saves.
The CIS Rejects are playing this rather well. Whenever I see those kind of like pushes at top lane and then they lose their Wisp after a relocate save, they're always like hard pushing the other lanes. They're never giving Power Rangers an opportunity to take advantage of the Wisp while he's down.
Oh, Razor forces the Nightstalker ulti out, chasing after him with that Shiva's Guard, and he has two pigs, and Cheshire Cat's like, give me those pigs, I wanna eat them. They're like his mortal enemies at this stage.
Yeah, they really are. They're gonna go in, they're actually turning to fight against Lissardo, who's popped his BKB. Iceberg is gonna be taken down though, there's so much minus armor there, and the relocate failed. Cheshire Cat is fortunately tanking up to survive through this. Nice double stun with the Chain Frost over the top! Oh, that's gonna be a cleanup right there! Now some buybacks out from CISR, but this is heavy committal. They're gonna come in with the relocate, but he doesn't grab anybody! Coots! Uh-oh! Alright. It's actually Power Rangers. They realize with all those buybacks, they just need to try and get out, not focus on getting those support kills. Iceberg whiffs his stun. Looks like J4 is going to be the only kill, but that was, what, four buybacks? Bignum? Whoa, Bignum? Winter's Curse on Akuts. No, he's not even going to get him. He's going to fly up onto the cliff, and it looks like he will be okay. Jesus. Oh, whoa. Hawk? That's a play I haven't seen before, but Bignum's still out.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever seen a Hawk tethered before myself. So I'm thinking now the Lich picking up Ags, it was too easy for me to think about the most recent thing that people talk about, but it's not actually because of infinite bounces. I mean, that's just ridiculous. You don't need that. It just gives more damage and cast range, and if their plan is for Slaughter to blink in and catch two people to stomp every time, it's going to do great work. I mean, they lost the fight, but we saw the potential there for the Lich Slaughter combination for sure.
Yeah, I've never actually noticed the increase in cast range before. I've only noticed the damage, and obviously infinite bounces is what everyone likes to talk about, but it goes up 300 range, 850 cast range. That's a pretty absurdly long. Iceberg, target here, Coots. He does have a relocate, but they're going to be able to get a Primal Roar on Templar Assassin to slow down their jump. They're still going to go for this one, actually managed to get the stun on to Go Black, and he can't turn around and do anything with the cast core. It's also going to be cleaned up as well. Power Rangers actually striking pretty well here. They jump forward, unable to catch the Wisp, but still, two kills there. They still have to worry about it. They got to get better control. They got to get some pickoffs now while there's two heroes down and the creep waves are decently pushed out, because otherwise they're just eventually going to lose a lane of racks to the tiny Wisp.
At the same time, CIS Rejects, I mean, the fight that they won at mid lane, I say they won it, but it took buybacks. I mean, there's a buyback cooldown on Tiny, on Beastmaster, and on Witch Doctor for another 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. And that's putting them under a lot of pressure, because if one of those, especially if the, I feel like if the Tiny dies, the game just ends, something like that.
Oh, what a two-man stun! Now the Chain Frost's gonna bounce around as well! Coot! He gets the relocate out, but they've already done enough damage that they can't just come right back into the fight. They're gonna go onto Razor, knowing they've got this heavy advantage pushing forward. Still though, the Tiny Wisp's gonna be coming back soon. Oh, never mind, they've got a Winter's Curse, and Coot doesn't bring the Tiny back. He untethers and tethers back out. Now the jump in from Iceberg actually catches two with the combination. Cheshire Cat will survive. Zara will be okay as well. Power Rangers may just have to call this a wash. Getting the kill on the Razor and backing out from there. Not any real damage done to the tier 3. I think part of the problem... Oh, their Roshan is up. I was going to say maybe Roshan isn't up and that's why they're not going, but Cheshire Cat, he's going to be controlled by the Primal Roar. Dunk in from the long range creep. Fortunately, get the Glimmer Cape plus that Cold Embrace to keep Cheshire Cat alive. One step ahead of the Avalanche as well, and Power Rangers all start clearing out. CIS Rejects not going to pursue, it looks like, but very surprising that Power Rangers chose to stick around for that second engagement, because they just as easily could have cleaned up Roshan by now. Doesn't look like they're going to have any issues with it, though.
They're very lucky they didn't get punished for it, though, because you can see exactly what's happening there. They know they nearly killed Tiny, got relocated out. They know that if Tiny died there, it's basically the game. It's two sides of Rax for sure, because they knew he didn't have buyback. And I think there's a stubbornness there, but we nearly killed this guy. The game would have been over. Come on, let's just like give it another go. And that kind of thinking gets teams into trouble a lot. So I think fortunate for Power Rangers, they didn't get punished. They got out fine. They still got the rush, and they're still looking pretty solid in this game.
Do you still complete the butterfly with the Templar Assassin completing MKB?
No, I would say definitely no.
So what do you do now?
Especially because Templar Assassin is like the hero that Tiny's been most interested in killing.
Yeah. Wow.
But he finishes it, so I mean, he knows better than me. He's a professional player. I'm not. Yeah.
I guess there's still the flutter effect and there's still two right-clicking heroes, but I agree with you. I think that But what would be the other item? If you wanted to increase your survivability, would you go hard?
I don't know. Maybe he needs a BKB. I mean, he's being hit by a whole lot of chain frost. There's also just the disable and Nightstalker's silence, Slaughter, Storm. Yeah. Maybe the argument for the butterfly is that you already have the talisman. And so it's just like gold efficient based on the gold you've already spent. Because need more. He wanted some more attack speed as well. It does also give armor to have butterfly. And like you said, the flood is good.
Chain Frost gonna cancel that TP away. Goretz needs the help of Koods, but he's not stopping his TP. He says, see you later, buddy. That is not on me to save you. So they take away the Aegis of the Templar Assassin, but Power Rangers are gonna be happy with that, I think. If they can actually take advantage of the Beastmaster being down, doesn't look like they'll be able to, though. There's a heavy push at the bottom lane, and they just, I don't think they have the boots. They have zero boots of travels. I was feeling like they didn't have enough bots in order to deal with these kind of split pushes, and yeah, certainly not. Sardar, hello. Ding dong. Gotta get over there and defend your base, please. She will do so. Save that range track.
I think Power Rangers get the tier 2 top lane. I doubt there will be a contest here with Beastmaster down.
Yeah, but I really think CIS Rejects jump in for
They're picking out Slaughter.
This is a very obvious play in my mind. CIS Rejects very clearly try and push out the bottom lane and then go for the relocate out. Koods has his relocate. He's ready to go. They're going to relocate up to top lane and let the Tiny farm that one away. Now the Razor's going to get kind of caught here. He's really fast, but Shish Your Cat's just a bit faster. So they'll slow him down with Trap and the stun. This is a very silly kill that should not have happened. They brought the Tiny Wisp back, though. They actually collect the gem. That's huge. Big num. Oh, he almost got the Winter's Curse. He's going to have to use it on Koods here in a second. Throw it out soon. Doesn't get it.
Blink coming. They want to chase.
Oh, now they got the Haste Drone on Cheshire Cat. Going to catch up to Koods. He's got another tether in a second. They're going to go on to Cheshire Cat with everything they have, but a Cold Embrace actually saves him. And Goldblack is ultimate. There's nothing he can do about that one. Big Num still chasing forward. Doesn't have the blink to be able to catch up there. Maybe Koods. They've got vision.
Cheshire Cat. Farming.
Oh, amplify damage right back onto the Slardar, but...
Goretz just started farming the neutrals in
Did
the middle
really?
Of the fights. And then like Wyvern sees him and says, hey, Tia, come kill this guy.
Okay.
He literally he went down to this camp of the two Hellbase and like hit them a few times. Like, that's a strange move.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe he just lost control. All right, well, this is a great position for Power Rangers to be in. Time to push uphill.
So actually, now that the buyback cooldowns are off cooldown, hardly anyone has vault for it. Tiny is just a tiny bit off, a very small amount off, but if they were to burst him down, it would still be massive. Radiant structures are
fortified. A little bit of zappy-zappy. Slardar is going to be target fourth. Oh, he doesn't have enough. Now they actually pop that Armlin. He's going to be good with Cold Embrace on the side. Iceberg will be focused down. Next up, Razor, who just gets torn apart with the amplified damage on top of him. And Zara. He just does so much. This Templar Assassin, who was way far behind at one point in time, sitting at 7k when the Tiny was over 10k, has actually caught up quite a bit and is now just tearing this game a new one. Well played by Power Rangers. They even out the series 1-1.
Yeah, not really that much more to say. And Power Rangers will be feeling pretty confident about themselves, I think, because... yes, they lost the first game, but firstly, they got Huskard, like last pick Huskard.
Yeah.
And secondly, it felt like for a large part of the game, they had done really well. They stayed in the game. They got really strong. They ended up losing the first game, but they've dominated the second game. They did very well in the first game. I would say advantage Power Rangers going into game three.
All right. Well, unfortunately, there isn't going to be a game three as... Oh, wait. No, there
isn't.
There is. I'm sorry. I'm thinking of the wrong thing. I'm thinking defense, man. I'm like, two-game series, blah, blah, blah. So game three is coming up. My bad. We'll be back after a short little break.